Good afternoon. It's 12 o'clock. I'm Christine Bell, and I am really excited to be back with you today. We are translating the town hall, the COVID313 town hall, to Spanish and ASL. So we want to give folks time to get on the right line and get comfortable. Ophelia, please share the phone number for Spanish translation.
Si gustas escuchar este video en español, por favor marca al 313-626-7440.
Thank you, Ophelia. It's good to see you this afternoon. Julie, will you please share the instructions for ASL? Thank you so much, Julie. And we want to hear from all of you out there. So if you could please drop your comments in the Facebook chat, we have some wonderful moderators there waiting to hear from you with your comments and questions. Libby, Brooke, and Lindsay are waiting on you, or you can text them to 313-288-2082. Again, that number is 313-288-2082. And, you know, just to test it out, why don't you share right now, where are you joining us from today? Just like make sure our moderators are on it right now. And while you do that, I have the pleasure of welcoming our Lisa Hurd to kick us off today. Am I right about that? Okay, Jametta, I think it's to you. Sorry about that.
Absolutely fine. And you know, I was being a good team player. I said, I'll just be quiet for a moment. It's all good. Sorry, it's all that. Good.
Okay. Jametta, it is so good to have you back, or to be back with you.
Yeah, so, and I'm in and out a little bit, aren't I? And it's understandable. So thank you so much, Christine. It's a joy to be with this really awesome COVID313 community coalition. Our weekly town halls are quite frankly a joy. They are a joy because I can tell you families that every single individual, every single organization that has been doing this voluntarily for almost a year is doing it out of profound love. Out of love and what we know keeps our community going. And that is a sense of responsibility, but the recognition that as we can share knowledge, we know that knowledge is power. And in that context, it makes me think about, we are almost at the end of another month of African-American history. And many of us recognize that, unfortunately, we still need to have a focus on African-American history because so much of it has never been integrated into American history. But if I could, I'd like to suggest this. In my role where I'm blessed to serve as the CEO of the Detroit Parent Network, I'm also a wife, a mom, a nana, queen nana, actually, and a long-term Detroiter. We are all like many of you. We've lost people. We've lost people that were pieces of our hearts. And so one of the things I want to suggest to all of us, all families, and in particular African-American families, where more people are being cognizant to reach back and better understand their roots, their ancestry, both on this continent, the Caribbean, and Africa, and all the way to the origins of man, you know, why don't we think about that? Let us make sure that we're hitting pause. We are in the midst of the most extraordinary time, probably in modern times and history. So let's capture our stories. If we haven't been asking our great aunt, our uncle, our great great grandmother, those that are with us, the time is now to pick up that phone, grab your tablet and ask them to tell their story. Don't force it on them. Just ask them to talk about their childhood. Ask them to tell you, what do they think about the pandemic? What are the lessons that they would love to share so that you now that we can share their lessons, their strengths, their perseverance, their fortitude, their hopes, and their pains, and integrate that into our story now, because we are now having to have tremendous fortitude, facing pain and hope, and doing all of this with the focus on our children. So that's my Black History Month suggestion, is that all of us, if you haven't done it, grab you the old fashioned way, a pad. We can write things out too. Grab your phone, call people. Let's capture this extraordinary time in the history of the world, in your household, in your family. Telling our stories is part of our power. Telling our stories is part of letting our children know both the greatness, the sorrows, and the things that we have been able to overcome. That certainly is part of my journey. I know it can be part of yours. And we know that that is so important to heal and help our children move forward. And that's the perfect segue for me to talk about Christine, where are we going to go today? Which is really having a focus on our kids. And while we know that our well-being as adults is critical, we've also got to pivot and start figuring out, how do I help my 2-year-old? How am I helping my 12-year-old? And how am I helping my 17-year-old? And so we're going to have an opportunity to really zoom in on the social, emotional feelings and mental health of our children, but also so importantly is to get back to schools and how schools are meeting this moment as we talk about return to school and what schools are doing real specifically to make sure that the social, emotional needs of our kids are just as important as them, what we used to call reading, writing, and arithmetic. Christine, I'm thinking reading, writing, and arithmetic. Now we also got to talk about, our heart and our spirit just as much, don't we?
Absolutely. So I, go ahead.
I believe we're almost to the point then that we can move into our first segment. So we want to make sure that you're comfortable, as Christine has said. Please text us right now. Get your questions going at 313-288-2082. If you are in Facebook watching us, you can send this information there. We're going to have not only the schools, we'll be talking about mental health, and because we are an advocacy group of folks that believe that you can't just talk, you got to walk and you got to advocate, we're going to have Arlisa come on and bring us some updates in terms of what we must do to make sure that educational funds are getting to our kids and families. So, hope you're ready for this really dynamic program. We have two guests that are coming to us. We are always so pleased and delighted to have Crystal Wilson with the Detroit Public Schools Community District. And also we have Sean Leonard joining us from the National Heritage Schools. Sean and Crystal, welcome.
Good afternoon, Jamata.
Good.
Happy
so what we'd
here.
Like to do is kind of start, so welcome back, I should say, right? We are all hanging out in cyberspace, we wouldn't know each other if we walked down the street, because we're used to just seeing ourselves in the spots. But to start us off, could each of you give us what the three highlights of what your back to school or back to learning plan is looking like for families to know about starting in March? And why don't I just switch it up a little bit? Sean, let's start off with you. What are the three big things that parents need to know right now, perhaps about not only your charter, but if there's any charter, other charters you can speak to? Please go ahead.
Yeah, thank you, Jametta. Happy to be here this afternoon. I guess I would share the three things that we would want our families to know as we transition back to in-person learning is that we've had plenty of our schools that have already began that transition. Our principals and our deans and our teachers have been making that transition since back in November and December to provide that in-person learning for our students, along with providing the remote option. And so one of the things that we want to make sure is that as much as possible, our families are feeling comfortable and safe coming back into our buildings. but at the same time, we're prepared. And so one of the things that we've done over the course of our planning is being very intentional with what we want to make sure that our students have been able to learn and master this year, even in the middle of the pandemic. We call this the learning loss standards. And so for each grade level at ELA and math, our teams have been very intentional with identifying exactly what those gaps are that students have and how we want to close those gaps, even in the midst of this pandemic. And so our instructional strategies that our teachers have been providing is connected to making sure that those gaps are being covered. But you spoke a lot early on with the opening about how impactful the pandemic has been on our communities. And so that's the other side that we also are very cognizant of that. And we've been very intentional with providing that mental health support for our staff, as well as our kids as they begin that transition.
Thank you. We're going to have some follow-up questions, but let me have Crystal, what are the big three buckets or highlights that you'd like to share? Thank you, Sean. Crystal?
Thank you, Sean, too, because we are on the same page pretty much. As you know, this will be a reopening for DPSED. We opened summer school and then we opened in the fall. And one of our biggest takeaways is to really help both students and teachers understand the importance of following the safety measures. One thing that we found out in the fall with being open fully is that the staff or the adults really have to take the responsibility to follow the safety protocols that are in place. And a lot of people fear that the school harvests a dangerous environment for COVID-19. And we found it to be not the school that harvests, but outside activity and by adults who don't follow the safety protocols and precautions. And so if we can stress it another time and more emphatically, this is the time where everyone needs to be diligent about following the safety protocols to keep each other safe as we go back in person. As Sean said, we've been transitioning since December 1st with the opening of our hubs. And so with that was an intent to provide full service resources and support for families. So during the virtual space, we've needed to help families repair their devices, which some will still use. We've needed to provide mental and emotional resources and support for families and other support resources as a result of the pandemic. People have fallen on hard times and even staff members. So continuing to provide those support resources for our families, even though we are going back face to face. That coincides with the third point is everybody isn't going back, and that's okay. We hope that our families and our staff choose to return in person because we know that's where students learn the best and they have the best resources. But there are going to be some students and some staff who are going to choose to stay virtual, and that's okay. There's no mandates at this time that they must return, but we know how important it is to be in the school environment proper, in the building, so that energy and that one-on-one face-to-face learning can take place. We saw it yesterday. We opened up the learning centers across the district, and it was just very, if I could use the word, magical to see that interaction happening. And again, it was definitely a shot in the arm for all who were able to safely visit a school and support our teachers and families as they returned.
Great. I'd like to go back to a couple of points that you made. Crystal, I'll start with you. So where are the learning centers and what's the criteria that you're using for who goes into a learning center versus who stays virtual?
So, you know, one of the benefits of a free public school is anybody can come into the school at any time to learn. And so when we open up the learning centers, we open them at all the schools to give families who need that extra support, the opportunity to bring their kid into school during the school day. They follow their school schedule. We feed them breakfast and lunch, and in certain schools, they get fed dinner, and they have that hands-on experience. Either teachers, some are opting to return to learning centers. We had a kindergarten teacher over at DIA who decided that she was done teaching virtually, and all of her teachers, all of her students returned to the learning center, so she met them there. But some of our teachers are still teaching virtually, so the students go to the learning centers and meet their teacher online through their device that we provide. And so we're opening this up to all K through 12 students who need that support right now. And it's also helping us to transition back to face-to-face in a way where people can come in, see, and be reacquainted with the safety protocols that are in place, understand the standards that we've put in place to ensure that everyone's safe.
Okay, and I really appreciate you underscoring the importance of the safety procedures, because with all of the talk about the vaccine, I believe yesterday, in fact, we were on a program with Dr. Levy and others who are involved both in testing and vaccines, and we believe that less than 10% obviously have taken the vaccine, which underscores the importance of continually testing. Could you, for a moment, as we, because not everybody knows when we say learning centers, well, what do we mean? Because we have charters and we have BPSED. Where are your all of your learning centers in existing school buildings?
Yes, all of the learning centers are in existing school buildings in existing classrooms. And so by classroom, by grade band, just say if I had a kindergartner, I would drop her off at DIA or drop him off at DIA. They would go into the building, do their health check, get their temperature taken, and make sure they have their mask on. If they don't have a mask, we'll provide it. Get their hand sanitizer. They'll practice social distancing. They'll walk to their classroom, and they'll have an adult in that classroom, whether it's a dean of culture or a teacher or one of our other qualified adults in that classroom. They'll be seated 6 feet apart, socially distanced, with their mask on, with their set of teaching tools that belong to them.
Yeah.
And we try to create that school environment. Everything is pretty much as it would be in a regular classroom. The only exception is there isn't a certified teacher physically in the building in all instances. It's another staff member or member of the school community that's there who are eligible to be in front of children, guiding them through their day and their coursework, because they do follow their same school schedule.
Right. Thank you. And I'll come back to that, but I wanted us to do a follow-up question with Sean, just for clarification. So if the classroom looks like a classroom, but it's set up based upon CDC recommendations, correct? In terms of social distancing, how the classroom is organized?
Is that for me or Sean?
I'm sorry, that's for you, Crystal.
You said Sean.
Yeah, no, I did. Okay, yeah. Thank you.
Yes, that's exactly it. We have to follow the CDC guidelines. And in certain instances, we're able to take it a step further. And we have limited the number of students in the classroom to less than 20. We know that our parents historically have been concerned about classroom sizes. And so as a result of the CDC guidelines and the opening of schools plan, there's no more than 20 students in the classroom. And so then for the overflow, they are then in another classroom, and we'll use as many rooms as possible. One of the opportunities to address challenges is most of our buildings have enough space, so we don't have an issue with spreading students out because our buildings have the space to accommodate the students who wish to come into the learning center.
Okay.
And it'll be the same for when we go back face to face.
Great, mm-hmm. That's good news. And now I will transition to Sean. Thank you. Sean, one of the things that you brought up, we've always worried about things. We used to call it the summer slide. Well, now we know it's not summer slide. It's a COVID, I call it a COVID avalanche in terms of how much our kids have been really set back from this. You mentioned about doing assessments and then that you are utilizing those assessments to inform what you're doing. Could you talk a little bit in more detail, particularly on those assessments, how you specifically are trying to address, and we want to move now to talking about mental health. How are you using assessments in your schools to help address the issues and needs of parents and kids around their social, emotional, and mental health?
Yeah, great question, Jametta. You know, that process for us actually began back in August and in September once students returned to school, both remotely and in some of our schools that were hybrid at the same time. And it's based upon the way in which we've developed our scope and sequence or the standards to be taught this year for each grade level throughout this year. So understanding that when our students, when the school shut down back in March of last year and we had to move to complete remote instruction, to your point, you know, there's definitely a loss that happens away from the face-to-face instruction that began back in March. And so we anticipated that and we developed our curriculum for this year to support that. So at the beginning of each unit in both ELA and math, we do a pre-assessment to determine what are those standards that are going to be taught within that unit and how much of a loss that our students may have experienced because of COVID. And then we built in extra time to support that loss throughout each of the weeks in teaching that unit, intentionally designing our curriculum to reteach those skills or provide more instruction time for those skills or standards so that our students have more time to grasp or master them. We also took a very close look at what are the priority standards at each grade level that we really want students to master as we begin this year and as we end this year. And that's been a part of our process as well. And so we have as a part of our approach, we assess those standards weekly and then provide reteaching opportunities for students using both the in-person teacher, if the schools are in person, or for our schools that began in remote, the teachers providing that as well. And as we start to transition back to full in-person for all of our schools, those same standards that we've been planning for is a part of that same structure of instruction. And so we've intentionally designed our curriculum to try to help support that COVID loss is what you're talking about.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. What can you just very briefly, you know, and one example of if a child has been identified of being just literally checking out, not available in the classroom, not fully present, or if they're doing a combination of at home, et cetera, and the parent is concerned, my child is having meltdowns once a week. What is it specifically that you offer?
Yeah, we do a couple things there. So one, we have our schools have additional staff to help support with those issues even before the pandemic. We call them our achievement behavior specialists, and their number one job is to help students stay engaged as much as possible. And so they've built strong relationships with students before the pandemic and even in the middle of the pandemic so that when I'm a student and I'm having those situations, mm-hmm. I have someone to receive that support. So even as the students have been operating in remote status, our achievement behavior specialists would regularly check in on those students each week, having scheduled meetings or calls to see how things are going. And so if the parent reached out or if the teacher is seeing that I'm a student and I'm not as engaged, now there's another opportunity for that support systems to be in place. The other thing that we do as a part of this approach, particularly with our remote structure, is our teachers actually provide one-on-one or what we call office hour support time where parents can connect with the teacher mm-hmm. on individual support beyond the scope of the structure of the school day so that we're getting that additional support for students.
That's great. Thank you. We have a couple of questions in our chat, and I want to pivot to that. But just before we do, how are both of you informing parents about this transition? So March is around the corner. Parents know there's going to be some changes. How are you informing each other, our parents? And Sean, why don't you answer that about parents, and then Crystal, if you will, and then we'll go to our audience questions. Go ahead, Sean.
Yeah, we're regularly informing our parents about the transition and what to expect through our parent newsletters, through our virtual parent coffees and principal meetings that they would have with their parents. It's also through the teacher communication. We know that that's a direct line of communication to parents as well. And so there's multiple ways in which our schools are providing updates to our families regarding as we transition to more in-person than where we were before, they have that support.
Okay, great. Crystal, how are you informing parents?
Yeah, similar to what Sean already described, the one thing that another opportunity that the pandemic provided was this virtual space, which provides access for students and families to engage with the district more through community meetings. Mm-hmm. I think I've lost track of how many community meetings we've held over the last almost year through Teams or Zoom to update families. And that's the one win I think that we could possibly cautiously celebrate through the pandemic, is that we have increased communication with their families and access to the superintendent and the board so that they could hear directly from leadership about the plans and times we've had to be flexible and pivot, you know, due to the virus throughout the year. And so we too, a couple of weeks ago, sent out a communication indicating that we would start transitioning back through the learning centers. And then leading up to the 24th, we did robo-text messages, calls, emails on every level from the start of the superintendent, just putting out a mass alert to staff to share with families. So I would say, speaking from the community feedback we've received, there's still some work that we can do in that space. But again, leveraging the staff, the families, PTA, the community at large to help our students understand the plan and the transition and what types of things will be expected in terms of safety. And then just also helping people to understand that there's options, because it's not a one-size-all approach, although there's different viewing opinions on either side. Yeah. We want our families to know that there are options, and then communicating what those options are so that everybody feels whole and everybody feels like their needs are being addressed.
That's great. Thank you both. Christine, I believe we have a few questions from our chat or audience.
We do. And I love that we're celebrating what has worked or been beneficial in this time, because I feel like we're in the last 6 miles of this marathon and it's time to give everybody water and throw M&Ms. So I appreciate the M&Ms you're throwing right now. A comment was, I've talked to parents who are hoping to send their kids back, but they're worried about who is vaccinated and who isn't. And another person said, and I think this actually gets at this person's comment, is are schools keeping track of how many teachers, staff are getting vaccinated? Upon returning, will there be different expectations for staff who are vaccinated and who are not? So could you just speak to what your schools are doing to track vaccination? And then are there going to be different expectations? And is that information going to be given to parents and families?
Yeah, those are super great. Go ahead, Crystal.
Go ahead, Sean. Go for it.
I'll pick so that you guys, Sean, why don't you go ahead at first, and then Crystal can.
No, those are really great questions. And I think it speaks at the heart of what Crystal was talking about before, and that is the safety aspect. And so one of the things that we've done over the course of this pandemic is really connecting with experts to develop our plan. And so we've partnered with a pediatric epidemiologist to help inform some of the things that I'm going to talk about here when it comes to the safety protocols, particularly through the lens of the vaccine. So yes, we do have a process that we keep track of the number of vaccinations across all of our staff, teachers, deans, principals, over the course of this time period right now. The question about would there be any different expectations? The answer would be no. And the reason why is it goes back to what the experts are telling us is that the mitigation measures that we have in place, the universal mask wearing, the social distancing as much as possible. So to Crystal's point, what we're seeing in our schools is that those things are actually working. When the virus is being presented within the schools, is actually based on things that happens outside of the school with adults. And so if we can stay focused on making sure that those mitigation measures that we have in place are being consistently implemented, the vaccines themselves, the guidance that's being provided lets us know that once both vaccines have been provided, there's still a window in which that transmission can still happen. And it's unsure about once I'm fully vaccinated, can I carry the virus and transfer to someplace else, someone else? And so it goes back to those factors being put in place with the universal mask wearing and the social distancing.
Great. Crystal, is there anything that DPSCD is doing differently or that you want to stack on top of that?
Yeah, I think Sean covered it because this is, a mandate from CDC and a provision by the state to get the vaccine. It's pretty much going to be consistent, I think, across all organizations in terms of what we are able to do. And in terms of being transparent, we are also doing the same with reporting. And also in terms of the second question around, I think I lost you guys.
No, we can hear you.
No, we've got you.
Okay, here you go. Somebody was trying to call me on Teams, and I'm like in the middle of a sentence, like, oh God. So same as Sean, but the only thing I would add is education is key. The vaccine isn't a mandate. It is a provision that's provided for those who feel comfortable with getting it. And I would encourage our education community just to get as much education as they can about the vaccine so that they are fully and awarely informed with all the rhetoric and some of the things in our urban community that historically have upset the community when we talk about vaccines, because it's real. And we want to take that into consideration as we navigate through this. And I can't say this enough. If people follow the guidelines, 20 seconds, wash your hands, wear your mask. 15 minutes is too long to be in close proximity with someone. Space, 6 feet apart. We haven't seen each other in a while. And there's a natural instinct to want to hug and want to fist bump and elbow bump. Like, don't do it. Like, elbow bump and move out. Follow the guidelines so that we can keep this education option open for our families and our students, because those who choose it, they need it. And this is really important.
So there's one additional question that I have that's not related to vaccines, but I just wanted to get a little bit of clarity. Are you able to share with parents what staff have been vaccinated or the percentage?
Probably the percentage, I need to check with our legal counsel based upon FERPA laws of exactly who, right? And I think that, and that's all I'll say to that so I don't get in trouble, but we are tracking percentage. And just as Sean indicated, the vaccine for Moderna and Pfizer isn't complete until you've had both doses.
Right.
And so then there's still that window that we know that the scientists and the experts have informed us on. And so that's why it's really critically important to follow those safety guidelines.
So maybe being able to share the percentage and that we need to keep following the safety protocol is what I'm hearing. And that's what we're going to keep on doing regardless of where we're at with vaccinations.
So just to give families a bigger context, when we did our Q3 survey, we did ask staff and teachers to provide us a heads up if they were planning to get the vaccine, and 60% of our staff and our teachers said that they would be getting the vaccine. So I just want to provide that up front.
Yeah, great information. So this has nothing to do with vaccine, this question. This is back to the parent interaction with their student and helping with student learning right now. What are schools doing to support parents and guardians who can't read or who don't speak English? How should they help their children with classwork?
Yeah, another great question. And I think
it's a good one.
It goes back to what we have been able to learn from this pandemic. And what I mean by that is one of the things that we have been able to do is utilize technology in a much stronger way to help support instruction. And so we have had our teachers and our curriculum specialists provide modeled lessons online that are recorded that could allow for students to access that same content to help support with some of the things that they need help with. So if I'm a parent and I'm struggling with reading, or I'm struggling with some of the math concepts, the resources that we provide to students is actually a direct access to how best to do that. So it's really just helping parents to connect with those resources is where we're at.
Yeah, I concur with Sean. One thing that we had already in place that was really helpful is our homework hotline. And through the homework hotline, we have staff who are bilingual, whereas the student can call into the homework hotline and receive assistance. And their family can also be at hand to hear the assistance in their native languages. We also have staff who are bilingual, who are at the ready to help our families who need assistance. And I do believe, as Sean said, technology is very helpful in this space because there's translation support tools that are available for the student to help their families help them. And so we're really conscious of that right now as we are exploring additional supports for ESC students, as we're exploring different supports for our ESL students. I was at DIA yesterday, which is a multicultural school with students from, we have international students who don't speak English. So the Dean of Culture was there speaking Arabic, and they were speaking Spanish. And there was just the synergy going that not only happens in the classroom, but it also happens beyond, so that we can ensure that no one's left behind.
Great. And if for some reason, you know, some of the systems that you've put in place are, you know, are not working for whatever reason, do you encourage parents to reach out directly to the teacher and say, I need support? Or is there someone else that a parent should reach out to?
They should always start with their school. We'd encourage them to start with your school teacher, principal, and you know our superintendent, he ain't shy to say, email me, because he'll respond. So if they can start off with their school level, that's very helpful to get them help faster.
Great. And yeah, then
Sean. I concur with that. Crystal's spot on. That's where the support is going to provide the most immediate response, is connecting directly with the teacher to unpack what's the real issue. And even if that doesn't work, it's actually connecting with the school, the principal, the school office. For us, we do have, similar to the homework hotline, we have a parent relations hotline team that parents can reach out to for additional support. And they just connect directly back to the school to try to problem solve what's the issue.
Great. Well, thank you both. That's all the questions that I have. So I'm going to kick it back to Jametta.
Thank you. Have a really great day.
It's good to see you both again.
It really is. There is one final kind of a ask that we have both for DPSED and also Sean, your charter group. You know, we've been seeing more and more, and we know the impact that mental health is really debilitating. And literally in this pandemic, we are seeing significant increases, not only in violence, in depression, in all the kind of behaviors that we as human beings struggle with when we're facing depression and other kinds of strains. We would really love it if you could work with us to identify someone on your team who can come and really specifically say, mom, dad, grandmother, here are some things that you can look out for, and here are things specifically that you can do in your home to help support kids. It'd be really important to hear that from our school partners, one, how you're doing it, but also to have the benefit of some of the expertise that we know either your social workers or some of your heads of departments can add. So that's an ask that we have for you. If not next week, the week after next, we would love to have someone come in and we'll be real specific about how you're addressing mental health needs and tips specifically for parents across different age groups. Is that doable?
We can absolutely do that.
Okay. All right, Crystal, I love it. Okay, great. you know, I put you on the spot a little bit, but I knew you were going to say yes, right?
You can handle it.
Yeah. I know you can.
It's needed, Jametta. Like, it's absolutely needed. So absolutely, we can do that.
Because we're all concerned. And we know that Department of Health and Human Services, we're seeing abuse and neglect to go up, all of these kinds of things. So we need every system talking about it, whether it's schools, healthcare, social services, all of us community-based organizations as well. Thank you so very much. Appreciate you as always.
Thank you, Jametta. And just for a plug for parents in the interim, because Sean and I are going to bring our experts, but we can have parents visit DetroitK12.org/areyouokay. That's our umbrella campaign. And we'll even visit your home if we need to and help provide support and resources, because this is important. And sometimes it's extremely urgent. So reach out, don't wait, and we'll have an expert to provide more details, but DetroitK12.org/areyouokay, because we're here to help.
Perfect. We'd love to learn more about that. And the community needs to know more about that. Thank you so much, Crystal. And thank you, Sean. Okay. And so we're now going to actually segue into a specific mental health segment. And we're really pleased to continue our partnership that we have with CHAZ, which is one of our awesome federally qualified health clinics that helps to serve all types of people throughout the city of Detroit, but a particular focus and it's a long-term focus in supporting the community in Southwest Detroit. We're pleased to have join us is Jesse Urban Guzman, and she is a licensed social worker and also background also in public health. And we know those two things fit, right? Mind and body. Jesse, we would love to have you come on and talk about the things that you're seeing at CHAZ around the social emotional needs, and in particular, how you're addressing the issue of violence and violence prevention, because we know that is sometimes a response that people have when they are under stress.
Absolutely. Thank you so much, Jametta, and I appreciate the opportunity to come and speak with everyone. My name is Jesse Irvin Guzman. I work over at La Vida at CHAZ Center, and we focus a lot on the issues of trauma, dating violence, and sexual assault among our youth and our adult populations. So I did want to let everyone know that February is Dating Violence Awareness Month. And dating violence is a serious issue in the city of Detroit and also in the nation. I was recently writing a grant, and I was doing some research and some studies, and I noticed that within the city of Detroit, 12.1% of high school students identified being a victim of physical dating violence in 2017. Now, the rate of that with the state is about 6%. So that was an identifying thing that raised a red flag to me and realized we really need to reach out and talk about what dating violence is and make sure that we as parents are helping to support our youth and our young people to have healthy relationships, relationships that focus on consent, and what those red flags are that we as parents can look for. So one of the things I wanna say first is, what is dating violence? So dating violence, a lot of times we do think of it as this physical abuse, the hitting, the slapping, the punching, but there are a lot of red flags that happen before it gets to a point where it's physical. So one of the things that I think it's really important to look for is controlling behavior. So if you notice that your child or teenager has a dating partner who's telling you, or you see things that don't look quite right, they're telling them, you shouldn't spend time with your family, your family's out to get you. You shouldn't spend time with your friends. They're trying to isolate them. Sometimes they'll put apps on their phone to make sure that they can see who they're talking to. So we're seeing a lot of those things with dating violence and sexual assault. And so I think it's really important for parents to continue to communicate with their children about what a healthy relationship looks like. So I know that some of the other things that we've talked about before are, what happens if, you know, my kids see an unhealthy relationship growing up with me or my partner, how is that going to impact them later? So one of the things I want to say about that is that youth are open to learning. They're open to communicating. Just because a youth has gone through an experience or seen an experience that's unhealthy doesn't mean that's where they're going to end up. But the important thing is to get them help and to reach out for resources in the community and in different schools. So I do want to identify that as well. Sometimes dating violence happens without having any violence in the family. It's a relationship that people get into. They don't realize that it's unhealthy. They have a love for this person. This person takes advantage of it. So I think it's really important to just kind of pay attention as parents and keep those lines of communication open. The other thing we really want to do as parents is to talk to our kids about what a healthy relationship looks like. So we don't just want to say, you don't deserve to be treated that way, just break up with them. We want to say, tell me a little more about what's going on with your relationship. Or if you see something that doesn't seem right, maybe you can say, I have some concerns about how that person is treating you. Can we talk about it? And sometimes I think, especially with teenagers, they may not feel comfortable coming to their parent. So we also really want to identify a trusted adult that we're close with, maybe a grandparent, an aunt or uncle, a godparent, somebody that they feel like they can talk to outside of the home as well. That way we're getting several different people who are supporting them and keeping them safe. A lot of the other things that we see with dating violence are also involves digital abuse and cell phones. Particularly right now, because so much of teens' lives are on their phone. Classes are online, although we're transitioning out of that. So we see a lot of digital abuse, which means that, for instance, somebody can set up their phone so that when you call them, their partner is seeing that phone call, or they're hearing that phone call, or they're recording their phone call. And some of the software that abusive partners can put on phones was originally designed for parents to be able to see what their kids are doing and track their kids. But abusers can use that and take advantage of it and know where kids are or where your teens are. So I think it's really important to keep an eye out for that as well. And just know that digital abuse, stalking online, sending maybe in an abusive relationship, the dating partner might send maybe, I don't know, 20, 30, 40, 50 texts a day saying, where are you? Why are you not where you're supposed to be? And so that type of abuse is a lot more common or happens quicker. And then it will end up eventually escalating to the physical abuse. So I want to just kind of let everyone know that dating violence doesn't look just like how we think it does. It starts out slow. It starts out subtle. And it makes it really difficult for people to get out of that relationship, because they love the person, they trust the person, and they don't want to believe that someone would hurt them. So in those situations, I would say that we as parents can support our kids. We don't want them to be hurt. We don't want them to be unsafe. But using that language rather than just break up with them, they're no good for you, helps you hear it a little bit better, because it is really hard to see it when you're inside that relationship. And of course, we as adults want to protect our kids. We want to make sure nobody would ever hurt them. And so the best thing we can do is sit down with our kids, let them know we're here for them, and we want to help keep them safe. And if anything happens to them that involves dating or sexual assault, the best thing we can do is not to blame them and sit down and partner with them and help them figure out ways that they can stay safe. And then also reach out for resources.
Jesse, that is really wonderful, wonderful information. And as a parent of young children, so hopefully I won't have to have any conversation like that anytime soon. But it just really struck me as really helpful of reminding to be a partner with your child and provide that support, even though you desperately want to just protect them. So thank you for that reminder. There's one question that's come in, and that is around, is there any help for the abuser that you can share?
So that is a tricky situation. I would say for teen abusers, the best thing that you can do if you notice that your child is perpetrating abusive behavior would be to get them into individual therapy. What you don't want to do is do couples, not that many teenagers are going to go to couples counseling, but sometimes if you're in the school, they may think they want to come into couples counseling and work out their issues, you know. You don't want them to do that together if there's abuse. If there's abuse, you really want them to find someone, a therapist that they can talk to, who will gently address issues of accountability. Because a lot of times abusers tend to think that it's never their fault. Mm-hmm. And they tend to blame the victim. So they create this situation where it's a lot of, it's their reality, right? So they need a therapist outside of the parent to really sit down and talk with them and point out the ways that their behavior is abusive and is hurting other people and is not okay.
Great, thank you so much. And then I just got another question and I feel like it's a short one so I can ask it. Does Chaz offer therapy for the entire family?
CAS offers a little bit of therapy for the whole family. Most of La Vida does individual counseling, but we have programs for adults and programs for youth, and we can bring them together as well. And then we also do go out to the schools as soon as they're back up. But we do have an official partnership with Western International High School to provide direct services on site, and also Academy of the Americas and Cesar Chavez Middle and High School. Great. And Covenant Academy too. I'm sorry.
You're fine. We'll make sure that we drop all the schools in the chat so that people know where they can find you all. Mm-hmm. And we'll also make sure that we put Chaz's information number in the chat. That is all the questions that I have. Thank you so much, Jesse, for being here with us. Jametta, I'm going to kick it back to you.
Sure. Thank you. And I want to echo the thanks, Jesse. These are topics that unfortunately are rarely discussed, but they are significantly impacting thousands of people and their behaviors that lead up to this kind of bullying that we need to be much more diligent on understanding those behaviors and beginning to correct them before they move to the point of either one being abusive or, for that matter, one who is consistently putting themselves, unfortunately, in situations to be abused. There are some dynamics there. So we're going to need to have more conversation about this because we have to focus more on our social, emotional, and certainly mental health. But we started off talking about health from the perspective of what's going on in our head and our heart. But now it's really time, as we always do, is to focus on our physical health. And in particular, Hannah, you know where we're going. We've got to hear from our public health partners about all the variety of ways that you are making sure that people get the testing and that wonderful TCF Center, which I'm going to say it right now. I have to give the city of Detroit, our mayor, and all of those volunteers and others out there. The TCF Center is run so well and nothing but kudos for that work. And every time I see those crazy lines in Florida, I'm like, y'all know what you're doing. You need to come to Detroit and see how we do this. Okay. So Hannah, if you would come on, please, and give us an update in terms of where we are relevant to vaccines and resources the Detroit Health Department is providing.
Absolutely. So I have a presentation for you guys. First, I echo Jametta is saying we've heard from the community that the TCF Center is running smooth as butter. I'm here today to talk about our COVID numbers, COVID testing, give you a little bit more information about the vaccine, and talk about how you can access it. Also, last night I was with the Detroit Parent Network, and I really got to thinking, you know, making the announcement of there's a lot of community leaders that are on this call. And if you want to lead and ask us questions about the vaccine and bring that information into your community, we're not going to force anyone to get the vaccine. Our motto is just get the information out. Please feel free to email us at dhdoutbreak@detroitmi.gov, and we will come to you via the Zoom sphere, or we can also come physically in a social distance presentation. We also offer in many different languages to meet the needs of the community. Mm-hmm. So I encourage you, if you're a leader in your community and you want us to come out, let us know. We are happy to help. Next slide, please. So this is the current situation of Detroit. We've had about 30,000 confirmed cases throughout the city. The average positivity test rate, which is a really great number, is 2.8%. And if you look at the numbers in comparison to Michigan at large, we are doing really well. The state of Michigan is at 3.7%. So that difference really shows Detroiters taking care of each other, wearing our masks, continuing to social distance, and practicing good hand hygiene. Mm-hmm. We've had about 1,800 tests a day. And while the vaccine is available, it's still important to access those testing resources if you feel sick, or, you know, we're also using it to monitor and decide where we're going to take our vaccines next. As well, the state of Michigan still does about 35,000 tests a day. So continue to use both resources of getting tested, getting your vaccines, hand washing, and social distancing, because these are our puzzle pieces that we have to slow the spread of COVID-19. It's not a one-shot wonder, unfortunately. Next slide, please. And so let's talk about a couple of the benefits of getting the COVID-19 vaccine. It will help you from getting COVID-19. The second one is that COVID-19 vaccine is a safe way to help build protection. And that the third is the vaccination will be an important tool to help stop the pandemic. So as I mentioned before, it's just one of the many things we have to slow the spread of COVID-19. Next slide, please. And I wanted to share a couple of our frequently asked questions. I'm not going to go through all of them, but let's talk about vaccine safety. So the question we get a lot is the COVID vaccine safe? And among the tens of thousands of people enrolled in the phase 3 trials of the mRNA vaccine clinical trials, those are our Pfizer and Moderna vaccines, none have experienced severe adverse reaction. This is not pretty uncommon for a vaccine clinical trial. And it's really cool because as the mRNA vaccine is only the message. So unlike some of our other types of vaccines, what's in this vaccine is really just the mRNA, which is a little string of nucleotides, which are just kind of building blocks to tell our body what to do. So essentially this piece of mRNA is the instruction for the vaccine, and it's using our body to, you know, protect itself. And then another thing I'd like to touch on is, do I need to keep wearing a mask after I get the vaccine? And the answer is yes. Individuals should continue to wear a mask, social distance from those who are not in their immediate household, and wash their hands even after receiving the vaccine. And all this information, as well as a lot more, is available on our website, DetroitMI/health, or you can always call us with questions at 313-876-4000. Next slide, please. And this is something that is new. So we have our COVID-19 dashboard, and it has the total number of doses that the city of Detroit has received, which is about 85,000 doses of the Moderna and 12,000 of the Pfizer vaccine. You'll see throughout the week that the doses administered, the percentage increases as we go through our weekly allotment of the vaccine. And then something new they just added was the future doses scheduled. So you can see how many people are scheduled to get the vaccine. So you know who we have coming down the pipeline. I also really like our doses administered by category. You see that we've vaccinated over 8,000 K-12 teachers and support staff. as well as over 31,000 residents, 65 plus, and our good neighbors. So if you want to learn more about the vaccine, I encourage you to visit our website. You can track the work we do. We're trying to be as transparent as possible. And you can watch as Detroit goes and administers the vaccine to our community. Next slide, please. So let's talk about who is eligible at the TCF Center. So any resident of the city of Detroit who is older than 65, as I mentioned, our K through 12 school employees and our wonderful support staff, our adult foster caregivers, our US postal employees, as well as our federal, state law enforcement officials, to name a few, our active members in the clergy who live and work in Detroit and whose ministry brings them into face-to-face contact with their congregation members. We also have our security guards and janitors, all of our identified populations in Group 1A, those are our healthcare providers, whether they're paid or unpaid, our Detroit residents with intellectual and developmental disabilities, and one caregiver of the residents, also any caregivers who work in a group home. If you are a caregiver, you can go to the TCF Center with your 18 plus who has an intellectual or developmental disability, and you can get your vaccine right alongside them in the car. We also have opened up our age 60 plus with chronic illnesses. And in order to prove your illness, you can just bring a doctor's note or a sample of an empty medication bottle, something that proves that you live with one of these conditions. And then we've also recently opened up the Good Neighbor 55 and older policy, where you can, if you live in Detroit or in the suburban areas, you can bring one of our Detroiters to the TCF Center with you. When you make the appointment, and I'll tell you how to do that in the next couple of slides, just let them know that you are a good neighbor and you are helping one or two other Detroiters get their vaccine. Next slide, please. So how do you make an appointment with the City of Detroit? So there's a couple ways to do so. You're gonna call us at 313-230-0505, Monday through Friday, 9 a.m. to 6 p.m. And what I really like about this is it kind of reduces the digital divide, because we've heard across the country that people are having to scramble to get appointments via the internet, but this is a simple way that you can call us and speak face-to-face with someone or phone-to-phone with someone about making your vaccine appointment. They're gonna ask you a couple of questions when you make your appointment, including your full name, date of birth, home address, phone number, and email. For workers and those other essential categories, just make sure you let them know where you work. And then when you get your vaccine, you're gonna bring a proof of employment. It can be a picture of your pay stub or just bring your work ID with you. During this time, you're gonna be given an appointment for two vaccines, so you don't have to worry about scheduling the second one. And then all instructions and reminders will be sent via text or email. And as always, feel free to check up with us on how to get a vaccine if you don't currently fall under the groups. We will eventually be opening up your age group or your essential status. Next slide, please. And for those who prefer to speak in and are more comfortable speaking in other languages like Spanish, Arabic, and Bengali, we have translation services available. The number is 855-393-4432. And I've also talked to our medical director, Dr. Dunn, at the site. And he says that if you speak one of those languages, they have interpretation on site and you can just let them know when you arrive. Next slide, please. And then what to expect on your appointment day. I always like to know what's gonna happen. So please arrive on time if possible. Make sure you have your ID or any form that shows your date of birth and your name. We use this information solely to put into our MICR, which is our immunization registration. It does not go to any other services besides tracking the vaccination. And then once you arrive, you're just gonna follow signs leading into the TCF Center. We're gonna verify your eligibility at check-in. You'll be asked if you have any allergies or precautions for yourself. And this helps our medical staff determine if you're eligible and if they need to take any extra precautions. Please anticipate about an hour for your appointment time and plan to remain in your car for the entire time. While it's still a little bit chilly, you can dress in a short sleeve shirt and then wear a jacket on top. It lets our nurses and our medical providers have easy access to the arm, which is where the vaccine will be given. And then also note that the TCF Center is having appointments between 8 a.m. and 6 p.m. Next slide, please. And I'm really excited to announce our Senior Saturdays. They are by appointment only, and they're for Detroiters 65 plus or those 60 and older with chronic conditions. And these are going to be taking place on Saturday. So to make the appointment, you just call the same number as I mentioned before, 313-230-0505, Monday through Friday, 9 to 6 p.m. to schedule. And then we have our four locations. We have the Fellowship Chapel, the Second Ebenezer Church, the Grace Community Church, and the Kemeny Recreational Center. You have your choice of which one you like to go to. If one's in your neighborhood, just request that one and we will happily schedule you an appointment. And as of now, we're scheduling for February 27th and March 6th. Next slide, please. And any questions you have, as I mentioned before, feel free to reach us at dhdoutbreak@detroitmi.gov or give us a call at 313-876-4000.
Hannah, well, again, that was incredibly thorough. And we really appreciate also that you have all of this available visually. There was a new slide that was really interesting where it broke down how these vaccines are being applied. Mm-hmm. And it was really great to see that unlike in other cities throughout the country, we've been prioritizing teachers as and childcare workers as essential workers. A question, there are a couple other stats that we're interested in hearing. One is, has there been a breakdown of race and ethnicity of your totals yet?
Not as of yet. I haven't seen any data come across my desk, but that's something I can definitely look into. I'm sure, you know, I know that they are keeping track of that. We just haven't published any of the data yet.
Yeah. And I really want to emphasize that because it's important. If we are in fact saying that we are making sure that we're being equitable, then the data needs to reflect that. And if it's not, then, you know, how are we making sure that we're addressing those inequities? Because they are there. And so, you know, that's something I think is important. The other is the total number of seniors. So if there are 100, I'm just using a number, are there 100,000 people 65 and older, and what percentage of them have actually been vaccinated? So the percentage of seniors, maybe we'll say 60 plus that have been vaccinated, would be good to know. The last question I had for you is, the city was one of the first ones to get out to the senior citizen homes and also the nursing homes. And we know those places were just absolutely devastated with COVID, as well as individual households. Can you give an estimate how many have been successfully vaccinated so far of at least the nursing homes and the senior citizen apartments?
I can. I have that piece pulled up. So they've actually added, since I made the slide this morning, additional categories.
Oh, great.
So we vaccinated, just refreshed. Okay. We vaccinated about 3,000 senior apartment members. Mm-hmm. Additionally, we have about 6,000 grocery store and our frontline workers. We vaccinated almost 2,000 people in our homeless shelters, about 4,400 of our city employees. And so all of this information is located on our website now. So they've done a really good job about updating it and showing the city exactly who we've reached. To give us information on where we need to go next.
That's great. It's really good. And to the degree that we can actually see those numbers in contrast to the total population for that group would really be great, because we can help. All of us here want to make sure that more of us in the community that want to get the vaccine get access. But and we know with new. So the last question I have for you, has the city begun to have any discussion? How are you coordinating with other businesses or other departments around getting information out about vaccines and returning to work, quite frankly, because there's more discussion about that.
So right now we are focusing mostly on our critical, you know, our staff, our seniors, and then our AFC members, our healthcare workers. So those are the businesses that at least my team is focusing on right now. And including when we go out and talk to the community, we're educating the residents and the staff. So we're trying to help people make the decision that's right for them. As we move to, you know, broader and open more areas, we're going to be working with our businesses. I know Ana Martinez did a presentation with our Mexican consulate. So we've also been working with Southwest Detroit. So as we, you know, build out our vaccine mission, we will be working with local businesses. And if there's anyone who wants to partner with us, we will meet you where you are. We are happy to help. So just come reach out to us.
Thanks, Hannah. Christine, do we have any questions in the chat? Or from you? Go ahead.
Yeah, we do. So I'm glad you asked the question, Jametta, about the tracking. And I think this, I'm just going to share this question with you, Hannah, just to emphasize that people are thinking about this out in our viewership. And it says, state officials reported on Tuesday that white people are about twice as likely as Black individuals to be vaccinated for COVID-19 in Michigan. What is being done to remedy this? So I think if we're not seeing that data, like Jametta said, we can't address it. And it would be, I think, really important for us to know what that looks like specifically in Detroit.
Yeah.
I know you're very good at taking questions back and coming back with us, back to us next week and getting us the answer. So I'd love for you to take that one back and bring the information back. And then the next question is, when will the vaccine be available for people of any age with chronic illnesses, conditions, comorbidities, and immunodeficiencies? This person really tested my
skills. That's a really good question. That's definitely a question that the mayor is making the decisions on. Right now, he's using the data to figure out who we need to target next. And you see that we are dropping our age, you know, pretty quickly in comparison to the rest of the state. We're really trying to get Detroiters vaccinated. So I know, you know, those patients are at higher risk and those people are at higher risk and they want to get vaccinated, but it takes patience. And, you know, if you have any specific questions, you know, about your own personal situation, feel free to email us at dhdoutbreak@detroitmi.gov and we will be able to get you a more precise answer.
Great, thank you. And then in our chat, there is this information in other languages? So is the PowerPoint available in other languages, specifically Spanish and Arabic? And I'm not sure if you said whether the documents, when you actually get to the testing center, if that information is available in English and in Spanish. So if you could very quickly speak to that would be wonderful.
Yes, so the consent form, we haven't created a Spanish version yet. We're working on it. All of our TCF information, I will send you links to. It's now translated into 4 different languages and growing. So we have a Spanish, Arabic, and Bengali translation of all that TCF information. So I'm happy to share that with you.
That would be wonderful. Good. So that we can get that out. So great. Yeah. Well, thank you so much, Hannah. We look forward to you bringing back the answers to the other questions next week. Jametta?
Yes. Yeah. Thank you, Hannah. And by the way, I think we should not only be asking our own Detroit Health Department this question, but team, we need to follow up with Wayne County and Oakland and Macomb, because we know it's Southeast Michigan and not even to mention Genesee, where we saw disproportionately high deaths, both contraction of COVID and deaths amongst African Americans, also First Nation people and Latinx. And we need to be diligent about those numbers. So thank you, Hannah, for advocating for us. And then we're getting ready to switch. Speaking of advocates, we want to make sure that we have one of our awesome advocates who has been helping to lead us forward, along with Molly and the 482 Forward team. And that's none other than Alisa Hurd. To get us straight, how do we make sure we get this money for our kids into the hands of our educators to be able to do what they need to do? Alisa?
Hi, Jabetta. You know what? I heard that you had so much money, all you had to do was write a check and take care of the whole state.
Oh, no, look, honey, if it was me, it'd have been done, right? It'd have been done.
So just really quickly, because I know we are a little bit up on time, I just wanted to, we kind of talked about this a little bit last week, but just to remind people, so I'm going to tell you what the money is called. It's called the ESSER money, and it stands for Elementary and Secondary School Emergency Relief Fund. And all that is these are dollars that the federal government has given down to the states. so the states can give them to their local education agencies or to the schools. Mm-hmm. And this is a normal process. Federal dollars come down to the states, states give it to the schools. It's not that, you know, schools were in great shape before this money, but everybody realizes that the pandemic has done so much damage and has had such an impact on schools. It's going to take a lot of money and assistance from the federal government to help us. You know, there's lack of resources. We had teacher shortages, mm-hmm. academic challenges, literacy issues, you name it. It was all happening at the same time. And the pandemic just highlighted all of that, right? So that's why the billions of dollars coming from the feds is so crucial. We absolutely need the money. And not only that, though, Jametta, there were also millions of dollars that was thrown in from the state, hundreds of millions actually, yeah. to help sweeten the pot, not just because they wanted to throw money around, but they realized just how much money Michigan schools needed. Now, all of that means nothing because right now, all of that money is being held up. So all of the money that could go towards help with learning loss, that will go towards further equipment, that could also go towards staying connected. We talked about mental health and wellness. That's a really big thing for our kids. They've been confined to a house mm-hmm. and a computer screen for basically more than a year. All of that money could help schools even with their air filtration, better mm-hmm. equipment, and stuff. All that money is just sitting because we have a standoff in Lansing with a few politicians. There is, and it's such a sad case, and I want to just encourage everybody, and I do believe we do have some information that we will put up on the screen. This guy that you're seeing on the screen right now, this is the one who's mainly responsible for spinning this thing off. Thomas Albert is the House Appropriations Chair. He's new to the seat. He's not new to Lansing, but he's new to this position. And what he has essentially said is he wants to make sure that the governor and basically anyone in the executive branch no longer has the power to call when schools are to close a school in a pandemic and basically not to shut down sports in a pandemic. This is what this is about. It's even gotten so bad that there's even a little bit of a struggle between this guy and some members in his own party. So what we're asking folks to do is we want you to bombard the emails, the phone lines, and we need to urge Lansing to release this money. Now, the money is there. They can't spend it for anything else. It's been designated by the feds specifically for the schools. What they're doing now is nothing more than a political game. It's just to see who blinks first and somebody is power hungry. But I say, don't play with our kids like that. Don't play with our schools like that. Do something else, but not that. So we're asking that everybody urge these people to release the money. And there's one other thing that people don't realize too. You know, you play all these games with money in Lansing, and what you do is you throw in some other stuff in the bills and you tie bills together so that if you only want one thing out of the bill, you have to approve all of it mm-hmm. or you don't get any of it. And that's exactly what's happening. Not only are we talking about school aid funds that's in this bill, we are also talking about rental assistance. We're mm-hmm. also talking about EBT monies. You know, kids get, that's a federal, the food program from the feds where kids were getting lunches and all of that every day. Well, people weren't getting lunches from September till now. That money that the governor has already said, the feds approved, that it could be going to families. They can get EBT cards specifically for their children, who from September until now, all the way retro, all that money is also allocated or designated in the bill, but it's not moving because of this fight. So we need everybody, get your mama, your daddy, or everybody, your grandmother, everybody needs to get on this, and we need to push these people and urge them, because the one thing that I do know that politicians get the most afraid of is not being reelected. So we need to make sure that these people understand that we need money for our schools. This is not a Detroit issue. I want you to know that this is the money for all Michigan schools. So that means Detroit, that means the UP, that means Grosse Pointe, that means everybody. So, yep. So we've got the information on the screen. Please make sure that you are writing, calling, texting, emailing, and please, you can also, I think we'll have additional information because we're also going to be doing some additional things. Good, there it is. That's his information there. You can go right now onto that link and send him a quick note. And that's it.
So it's in our hands. And just to add to it, the community should know that the Michigan Department of Education, the Department of Health and Human Services, our district superintendents know and have a plan of how to spend that money. They need the funds released. It's not that there's money sitting there and no one is willing to be accountable or has a method and a reason for how it should be spent. Those plans are there. Our principals, our superintendents, our directors of departments need those funds to make sure they're providing the services. Thank you so much, Arlisa. And this is what we got to do, folks. This is, again, unprecedented. Millions of dollars, millions and millions of dollars. In fact, I think it's over
$2.1 billion,
right?
And that's just designated for the schools. We're not even going to talk about all the other money that's being held up in that same bill.
Yep. Thank you so much. Let's get on it, folks. Let's get on it. And speaking about get on it and get off, I'm going to hand it to Christine because we've had another, I believe, dynamic program. I do just want to emphasize it. Remember, folks, start talking to your family now. Get our stories, write them down, share. This is the time. Next month is Women's History Month. We have lots of things to celebrate, how far we've come and how much further we have to go, not only for women, Black folks, Brown folks, but let's start writing about it. Let's talk to our elders about it. And not that you or I, Christine, are elders, right?
I hope not. Not yet, but I, you know, Jametta, I love that you gave that suggestion. We, our staff were talking yesterday and we were talking about the background of Cinco de Mayo, and one of our staff's family is from Puebla, and she told the story that her mom told her of her understanding. It is so powerful hearing stories about historical events from people that either they're passed down to or lived through them. And I think it really gives us a better sense of the emotion and the importance of them. So thank you so much. It was you when you said that, I was like, what an amazing idea. And Arlisa, I just really appreciate how calmly you just talked. about what is going on in Lansing, because I have a few choice words about the frustration, knowing that, you know, these dollars need to be put to use right now. We're going back to school. Schools need them. And then all the other things that are in that bill that are also needed for us to recover from this pandemic, which has been really devastating to all of us. You know, and yes, people have lost people and we some people have obviously suffered more, but this has affected all of us deeply. Mm-hmm. And to hold something like that when we're tired and we've sacrificed, it just seems
evil.
Right. Just really frustrating. So call if you think that we should talk about executive powers outside of talking about dollars for pandemic, for relief, please call. So that's my little plug. You were so happy and more eloquent about it. But that's it. We're done for today. Remember that we always want to hear from you. So keep your comments, keep your questions coming. You help to make this town hall what it is, and you really help to shape what it is that we talk about. And so we can't have good conversation about what to talk about next if we don't hear from you. So please continue to talk with us. The only announcement that I have outside of the ask that our Lisa gave was my organization, Urban Neighborhood Initiatives, which is in Southwest Detroit in 48209, has COVID testing this Friday, so tomorrow from 2 to 6. And we will also have gleaners giving their fabulous food baskets away from, I should know this, 2 to 4. So if you need to get tested for COVID, come on down. It's a mobile clinic. It's fast and efficient and pretty awesome. And then also if you're in need of food right now, it's the end of the month. So come and visit us for one of Gleaner's awesome food boxes. And that's it for today. So we want to remind everyone to stay powerful, stay strong, and stay informed. And Ophelia, could you say that in Spanish?
Queremos que todos que se mantengan poderosos, que se mantengan fuerte y que se mantengan informados.
And I forgot, stay healthy. Could you say that?
I know, like, she didn't.
Yeah, during the pandemic, right?
Yeah, well, you know, forget healthy. No, and stay healthy, everybody. Thank you so much.
Stay strong, everyone, and be blessed. Thank you. I'm going to start calling.